Hello. Where are you after?
The beach.
It's nice at the beach, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you surf?
No, my dad won't let me. Says it's too dangerous.
What does he know? Big meanie. Are you here on holidays? Where are you from? Wicklow.
Yeah.
Never mind. We won't hold it against you.
Janine, get in the car. What were you saying to her?
I wasn't saying anything to her.
Oh, really? You looked deep in conversation to me. Where the hell did you get to, honey? I've been looking all over for you.
I think something that strikes me with this so much is that he doesn't want to abdicate the responsibility, because what happens in the clergy affects us all. Like, in effect, he's taking that priest's sin onto himself, as well as the hurt and pain of the other guy. And that's something that is very clear throughout the abuse scandals as well. We were all the people who suffered the most outside of the victims, obviously, are the priests who didn't do those things, because we're seen completely differently. I remember when the scandals first broke, I was in the seminary. And of course, that really shook us. And the scandals in Philadelphia, and I was, and in Boston, I was in the seminary in Philadelphia. So it was like right there. I mean, people you knew, you know, and it was incredibly painful. And I came home, and growing up, you know, it was the general respect for priests and things like that, just like there was for police officers and all these other kinds of like public servants, if you will. And I was walking through the grocery store, and I was a seminarian, but I had the collar on because I was working at the parish and they asked me to wear it. And I went to the grocery store, I was walking down the aisle, and there was this little girl walks by with her mom, and she's like, hi. And I said, hi. And her mom just looked at me, and she faced up to me, and she spit right in my face. And so the scene in the film where where the man stops him and is shaming him and basically saying that his intentions are bad because he's talking to his daughter. You see the look on Brendan Gleeson's face. He played it so perfectly, where it's as though all of the joy just gets just drawn out of him to have to suffer that, even though he's a good man. It's very painful. So for me, that movie resonated in that experience.
This is Criteria. All right. Hi there, everyone. Welcome back to Criteria, the Catholic film podcast. I'm James Majewski, here with my co-host, Thomas V. Mires.
Yo.
And we're here to talk about one of my favorite movies with one of my favorite people, a dear friend and spiritual father from the Diocese of Arlington, our home diocese, Thomas and I, Father James Searby. Father, thanks for joining the show and being with us today.
Thanks for having me, guys. It's great to be on.
So yeah, what movie are we talking about today, Thomas?
Well, we're going off of our usual fare from the Vatican film list. This is a film probably some of our listeners have some familiarity with, even if they haven't seen it yet. That's Calvary, an Irish film from 2014, directed by John Michael McDonagh, starring Brendan Gleeson as a priest. John Michael McDonagh is not that well known as a director. He's only done three or four films, and this one probably got the most attention in our country. But he's the young... I don't know if he's the younger or older brother.
He's the older brother.
He's the older brother of a better known playwright and filmmaker named Martin McDonagh. Martin McDonagh is most recently known for Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri, and also for a cult classic In Bruges. And the two of them have a very similar dark, transgressive sense of humor, for sure. But this is a more serious movie. Some critics mistook it for a black comedy. I would call it a drama with a dark sense of humor. And basically, it's about Brendan Gleeson plays a priest. And at the beginning of the movie, he's in the confessional, and a man comes in and tells him he was molested by a priest as a child. And before Father James actually is the name of the priest in the film, as well as our guest. So we'll have to figure that one out. But before he has time to really process it, the guy goes on to say that he's going to kill Father James because he was molested. He says he doesn't think that killing a bad priest, the guy who molested him, is long dead. Killing a bad priest wouldn't be a surprise or shock to anybody, but killing a good one, an innocent one, that would make people pay attention. So he tells him, though, that he's going to give him a week to put his affairs in order.
And then the rest of the movie just plays out with each day introduced. Brendan Gleeson, I think that's how I'm going to get around this one. Instead of saying Father James, I'm just going to say Brendan Gleeson.
Yeah.
Goes through his days more or less as usual. He's visiting with parishioners. He's administering the sacraments. He's spending time with his daughter, because his character was married before the death of his wife and then becoming a priest. And all the while, he's kind of trying to figure out what to do about this end of the week, this Sunday next.
One of the interesting things about the film is you know, how much of it is spent focusing on other things than that.
Right.
You know, it's like the life of a parish priest. The film explicitly references the film Diary of a Country Priest by Bresson, based on the novel by Bernanos.
Yeah.
And I would say that and a lot of the encounters, a lot of the characters he deals with are clearly based on, are referring to characters in the Diary of a Country Priest.
Yeah.
But they're kind of like, it's kind of like a more comic cartoon color version of the more mundane, in some ways, humiliations suffered by the priest in Diary of a Country Priest.
Right. So, we're talking about this movie today. I've seen it many, many times. Thomas, it was your idea to ask Father James Searby on to talk about this. I'm guessing you did that for a reason other than the similar name.
Yeah. Well, I wasn't thinking about that. Well, Father James, I wanted to have you on. I think this is literally my first time calling you Father James. I've always called you Father Searby, so this is just stupid because now I'm calling you by the name of the character, which I never call you. Anyway, I asked you to come on because I remember we all saw this film when it came out in theaters, and I just happened to remember that you really liked the film at the time, and you were a priest, and so I sort of at the time took that as, okay, well, this is good stuff then. And I certainly heard, you know, reports online of priests maybe even I think a seminary director or something really liking the film and saying how relevant it was to the kind of like the crucifixion that you can expected to suffer as a priest, and really in a sense, you know, the fact that he's got a death threat, a death sentence hanging over his head is not even the most striking of the ways that he's crucified throughout this film.
Yes.
What's striking is the cumulative effect of the overall hostility. This film is set in a small Irish village, Sligo, on the coast, and a beautiful village. And it's set in the wake, of course, of the sex abuse scandals, which were particularly bad in Ireland and resulted in a particular hostility and distrust of the church. And that plays into the situation. Like, it's a small village. Everybody knows the priest. He's at the local pub and things like that. And yet they're all kind of at arm's length from the church. Father, so one reason I wanted to have you on is kind of to see how this film resonates with your experience. You've been a parish priest. You've been a university chaplain as well. So I maybe we can just start with kind of how this, what you think is specific to your experience as a priest that informed your response to this film.
Yeah, I think the first experience I had of the film, I mean, obviously I've watched it many times and even taught a class at the university when I was there on religion and film. And I used this, you know, I went through different religions and I said, this is the Catholic film. And it was interesting because a lot of people want it, you know, how about the Bells of St. Mary's or something like that, which are all wonderful films, all these things, but they're quite sentimental. And this is the exact opposite of the sentimentality. And I think a lot of people have a sense or an experience of the priesthood through cinema that's not quite accurate. You know, it touches on aspects, but this really shows a man who is passionately in love with Christ and the identity that he has. And it's commented in the middle, in the beginning of the film. He's always wearing his cassock, or I'll call it a soutane as well. And why do you wear that thing, that antiquated thing? Because this is who he is. I have a vocation, he says. And he sees his life completely at service. Kind of reminds me of the Holy Father when he says, you have to smell like your sheep. And he's willing to do that. He just goes and he's with his people all the time. So what struck me about it was that he knows from the very onset of the film that he's going to die. And then he serves his flock. In effect, that's really what the priesthood is, that we know that we are going to die for our people. Hopefully not in the way in which he dies in the film, though he went quick. But sorry, if that was a spoiler alert. People haven't seen it. But really what he's doing, it's aptly named. It's named Calvary for a reason. He's living Calvary. And Jesus knew he was going to die. And I think that's something very interesting. In a very small town like that, he most likely in himself knew who the person was that was talking to him in the beginning of the film and threatening him. I imagine he probably recognized people's voices.
Yeah, I think it is mentioned the bishop. He at one point in the film, he speaks with his bishop about this threat. And I think he indicates, I do know who it was.
Yeah.
But that's something that we're never allowed to know during the film. That's kind of one of the things that this film does, is that it plays with our suspicion as an audience of these different characters, at least the male characters, because we know that it's a man who has approached him in this confessional. Right. And so throughout the film, there are little things that the camera will do where a character will sort of like appear behind Brendan Gleeson's character, or, there will be like a cut to another character that'll be strongly suggestive of maybe it was this guy, or maybe it's this one who has it out for him. But it's not until the end of the movie when we as the audience are led into the knowledge that Brendan Gleeson's character has of who in fact it is. And then it's interesting to go back and rewatch it, knowing that Brendan Gleeson's character knows who it is that's threatening him, and then tracking how he treats this person, how he treats the others. You know, he really kind of loves them all with a pretty even hand.
Right.
Yeah. Well, Father, you mentioned, you know, people's view of priests being filtered through Hollywood. I mean, I don't think I've ever been called my son by a priest ever.
Right.
In a confessional. Ever.
I think maybe that was an old thing.
You know? Well, that's what I think. You know, I think that a lot of what's memorable, like aesthetically, about the church and the priesthood tends to be stuff that's like kind of pre-Vatican II, to be honest. And that's still exactly what you see in films even today. It's like that kind of architecture, not necessarily the Latin Mass, but, you know, the my son, that kind of really super priestly attitude. Right. And but in this film, he definitely has the smell of the sheep. I think it's interesting how he responds to this threat. He's clearly not sure whether the person's going to follow through. Mm-hmm. And kind of ambivalent about how to respond to it. Like, why do you think he doesn't want to go to the police or anything like that?
I mean, it's a good question, right? Because
maybe he feels the guy has been hurt. So
yeah, I think he's taking on the sins that caused this man's hurt. And so in effect, he's living the hurt along with him. It would be a terrible catalyst for a story if he just went to the police and it'd be like a 15-minute film. But I think what he's doing is showing that what is he? He's a priest. And what does a priest do? He's an alter Christus, another Christ. And Jesus didn't go off and call up an army to help him. Jesus knew who was going to betray him. He predicts it many times in the scriptures. But Jesus also willingly goes to Calvary. He willingly goes to the cross. And that's exactly what Gleason's character is doing, is he's willingly walking with his people, knowing that it's going to lead to his demise. In effect, I mean, that's what a priest does, is he willingly walks with his people, knowing that he's walking away from comfort.
CatholicCulture.org is funded almost entirely by user donations.
That means everything from our articles on commentary, news, liturgical year stuff on the website, as well as our podcasts and videos. All of those are maintained basically by your generosity. So during this Easter season, we're running a fundraising campaign in which a few of our key donors have generously offered us a $50,000 matching grant. If you, our listeners and readers, can collectively scrounge up 50 grand, that amount will be matched by these donors. This fundraising is essential to keep our work going. And by the way, the podcasts really tend to cost a lot more money to make than they take in by way of donation. So I would love to have some of our podcast listeners and YouTube audience get more involved in supporting our work. So to do that, you can go on over to catholicculture.org/donate/audio, and your donation will be earmarked specifically for our audio and video content, actually. Yeah, basically all of our podcasts. If now's not the right time for you to make a contribution, then please at least throw us some prayers, and we'll be very grateful for that. All right, now to the show.
The film gives us gives Brendan Gleeson's character a way out through the bishop, who tells him, well, there you have it. The man is not penitent. He hasn't confessed a sin. He's threatening a future one and a crime. So the seal of inviolability doesn't hold here. And so he tells Brendan Gleeson's character, the choice is yours. So then that puts us as an audience watching this unfold, we have to consider his motivations differently, because now we know that his hands aren't bound by the seal of confession or the instructions from his bishop, that now Brendan Gleeson's character really is exercising his choice, his free choice. And there's a line at the beginning, in that opening sequence in the confessional, when Brendan Gleeson asks, have you spoken to anybody about this? And the penitent says, or the would-be penitent, the assailant, says, I'm speaking to you. And yeah. And I thought that was very striking, because it was like, he is talking to someone. There is some responsibility here on you, that you can't ship it off to the police or to a psychiatrist, a specialist. Right? The priest is not a specialist. He's a spiritual father. He's an alter Christus. Mm-hmm. And he has his own imperative here in this context, you know? And I think you see Brendan Gleeson, this you know, this good priest. The characters throughout the film continue to call Father James in this story a good priest. You see what a good priest does in taking on the sins, taking on the responsibility, and really choosing to love this man, even to the threat of death.
To the threat of death. I think something that strikes me with this so much is that he doesn't want to abdicate the responsibility, because what happens in the clergy affects us all. Like, in effect, he's taking that priest's sin onto himself, as well as the hurt and pain of the other guy. And that's something that is very clear throughout the abuse scandals as well. We were all the people who suffered the most outside of the victims, obviously, are the priests who didn't do those things, because we're seen completely differently. And, you know, it's like I've often talked to, you know, I live in the Washington, D.C. metro area, and there's people in the military here all the time. And the ones who get it about that are especially people like the Marines and people who are part of a military cadre, because if a small group of them go and do something. I remember during the Abu Ghraib prison, you know, scandals and things like that. People started to look and think that every soldier, every Marine was like that. And that happened to us. I mean, I remember when the scandals first broke, I was in the seminary. And of course, that really shook us. And the scandals in Philadelphia, and I was in Boston, I was in the seminary in Philadelphia. So it was like right there. I mean, people you knew, you know. And it was incredibly painful. And I came home, and growing up, you know, it was the general respect for priests and things like that, just like there was for police officers and all these other kinds of like public servants, if you will. And I was walking through the grocery store, and I was a seminarian, but I had the collar on because I was working at the parish and they asked me to wear it. And I went to the grocery store, I was walking down the aisle, and there was this little girl walks by with her mom, and she's like, hi. And I said, hi. And her mom just looked at me, and she faced up to me, and she spit right in my face.
Whoa.
And so the scene in the film where he's where the man stops him and is shaming him and basically saying that his intentions are bad because he's talking to his daughter. You see the look on Brendan Gleeson's face. He played it so perfectly where it's as though all of the joy just gets just drawn out of him to have to suffer that, even though he's a good man. It's very painful. So for me, that movie resonated in that experience. And it also resonated for me as well, because right when I was first ordained, a group of my priest friends, we all went on a trip to Ireland because we'd never been to Ireland. And so we took a vacation. We went over, we did a walking trip, and we actually walked through towns unaware of anything over in Ireland, mm-hmm. where horrible abuses had taken place, like at schools and things like this. And we were all in our collars. We decided we're going to go give a witness of the faith. And at that time, there was the brewing hostility, but there was still a latent faith that people had. But the questions that we got, people were curious and hungry about the gospel, but you could also see that they were starting to leave. And then just a couple of years ago, I went back to Ireland with some people, and it was the exact opposite. They would not look at me. They wanted nothing to do with you. So the movie really spoke to me in that way too, because you can see how Ireland was so instrumental in the evangelization really of the world, especially in the United States. And then now it's the exact opposite. It's really a wasteland when it comes to the faith.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the things that struck me about these characters and their sort of their venom that they direct toward this priest and to the church. I think it's a kind of venom that is only possible toward one's own, or like toward one's parents. Do you know what I mean? Like,
true.
It's like,
yeah, there's a familiarity in their sarcasm. Yes,
exactly. Like, I can take the church for granted in a particular way because I was reared in it. So I can be particularly vile. I can be particularly hurtful to Jesus. So this was something that I was thinking about too, just for myself. You know, what are the ways that I let my familiarity with the gospel, with the church, with the priesthood, you know, like how do I take that all for granted? It's shown in a really stark way in this film.
Yeah, that scene you mentioned, Father, where he's walking along to the beach with this little girl who is ambling beside him, talking happily, is, I mean, that's the scene that moved me the most in my first viewing of the film, you know, back in 2014 or whenever when we saw it. Because, yeah, the acting is so beautiful that he shows this like it's like he's been hit, you know. Yeah, exactly. So this actually reminds me, I probably mentioned this. Well, we've mentioned this because we watched an Alec Guinness movie earlier in this podcast. But it reminds me of the story of Alec Guinness's, you know, conversion and how he was playing the part of Father Brown in a film. And I think he was in France, and he was this movie's Irish, never mind. I was saying that like it was also set in France. The Diary of a Country Priest is French. So anyway, he was walking with this boy who was talking to him because he thought he was a priest, and the boy just like grabbed his hand, and he was so moved by that boy's trust that he sort of got interested in the Catholic Church. And so this is like the opposite of that.
Obviously. Right. You got to wonder if John Michael McDonagh is familiar with that story, because it seems so similar, you know,
right.
That Brendan Gleeson's character just sort of is walking and sort of comes along this little girl walking along and her, she's trusting. So she's not emburdened with the kinds of prejudice or contempt that these other characters are.
Yeah.
And they are having a nice conversation, but then this is totally misinterpreted by her father.
Speaking of familiarity, there's only a few characters with whom this priest has kind of an entirely positive, like friendly relationship, you know, and most of them are not Irish or their children. So there's his altar boy. There's the little girl. There's the French woman whose husband has been killed in a drunk driving accident. And there's the old man who I think is an American expatriate,
right,
who's living as a writer in this village. played by the wonderful, my goodness, what's his name?
I don't know.
I'm blanking on his name, but wonderful actor. He's been in a billion things. He's great in the Coen Brothers' Blood Simple, for example. Emmett Walsh. I think other than that, I mean, the closest you can say is maybe the police officer. I don't think the police officer ever really, like, he's obviously like living in vice, but he doesn't really do anything.
But he is a little ambivalent toward
sure.
the priest, and he doesn't really accord him any respect.
Yeah,
you know.
So you know, if you don't count him, the characters who are positive towards Father Brendan are two children and two non-Irish people.
Right, precisely. Yeah, and it's something you see. It's the people. Familiarity breeds contempt, I guess you could say. But they're also not, they're either young or from another place. They're not involved in the cynicism of the town as much. Even the boy, the altar boy you see most of the time, he's completely separate. It's as though he's not part of the drama that's going on in the town. So there's these interspersed moments of innocence. And you see he relates with them because he sees glimmers of hope. Even his daughter, who's very cynical, you see that there's a tenderness there. And that tenderness that she needs starts to grow. And this is what it is, I think, that every person who realizes that they're suffering and wounded, that are willing to admit it, are the ones who are able to receive what he's giving. It's the ones that don't admit it that push him away. He's a reminder, and I've said this very often, you know, as priests, sometimes you're ministering to people and all of a sudden they disappear off the radar. And you say, where'd they go? What happened? We're like Jiminy Cricket a lot of times. You know, we're the reminder of a conscience that they don't want to have. And so if you show up, it's like, oh, just standoffish. Or if they see you, they want to push you away. The characters that give him tenderness aren't trying to expiate their conscience. They're not trying to push him away.
Yeah, another thing that comes up a lot in the film is reference to, you know, other scandals elsewhere or in the history of the church. So there's talk about the missions and, you know, kinds of punishments that were given out or forced conversions. And also there's reference to financial scandal. And Brendan Gleeson's character has kind of a similar response in these instances where he'll sort of, you know, brush it off because it's always beside the point. It never has anything to do with this interaction between him and, right. and a particular individual.
That's one of the delights of the film is to watch him just.
He'll say, oh, you're getting good use out of that library card, I see, you know, or you know your history, like, and.
Very
and
sarcastic.
Yes, but it is, it's still totally relevant. I think that this film holds up really well on a recent viewing because these are still the kinds of issues that we're dealing with as a church.
Sure.
And you could say, like, more broadly as a culture, as Western culture, there's this sort of this edifice of contempt for sins of the past that is like you almost have to like get past this before you can even begin to talk about what's happening in the present. People just erect these walls based off of things that happened hundreds of years ago,
which they rarely know much about.
Right.
You know, it's not saying that bad things weren't done by people, but basically in it, what you're seeing is all the comments you ever hear about the church are thrown into the movie. You know, the church is only out for money, that priests are control freaks, that Catholicism has no power, answer for the problem of evil, all these things. And they're usually those are just the simple things to just, it's not relevant to me. Get away. They all get Heisman, you know, they're all getting pushed away. They're all trying to push him out of the scene.
Yeah. Right.
There's a sort of an odd opening. After we get that opening scene in the confessional and then have some time to process it. The movie gives us a lot of time to process it because it's like really
yes.
hard to listen to. This yes. movie is hard to watch, not so much in anything that it shows visually, but just the dialogue of the subject matter. Then we get Father distributing communion at mass, and it's kind of odd because all these characters that we see, it's kind of a way of introducing a number of the characters in the village, but you know, all these characters are so like over the top hostile and disrespectful to Father James that it's kind of weird that they would be at mass receiving communion
yeah
there. So like that, I don't know what you think of that, but it strikes me as a little bit contrived as like a way of kind of introducing them.
I thought that the first time that I watched this film, but upon rewatching it in preparation for this episode, I was really struck by that scene. I guess that what was different for me was that I was thinking about the sacramental reality that almost certainly all of these people are receiving unworthily, unless they're, you know, super ignorant, that Jesus is being crucified one after another, after another, after another, as the Eucharist is being given out to these people who pretty much for the rest of their lives are persecuting Christ. Mm-hmm. So that, I don't know if that was on, the director's mind. It might have been just as simple as this is an easy shorthand way to introduce these faces in the parish.
And to let you know for certain that these people are members of the Catholic Church.
Right.
Regardless of their hostility towards it. It shows you immediately.
Right, because that's like the big symbol, right? It's the big sign of communion.
Right. Yeah. But I would like to think that this other part is operative as well, that there is, at least in this instance, a nod to the sacramental reality of Jesus is being persecuted in all of this as well. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, you know, be honest, I think that this is a really great example of what beauty can do. When you try to create something that's beautiful and true, it can't help but be involved, draw the gospel into it, and to go to layers. I mean, if you watch interviews with John Michael McDonagh and Brendan Gleeson and the other cast members, even some of the additions that come on the video, I don't know if they really were grasping the depth of what they were creating, but when you try to make something that resonates with truth, it's going to necessarily have elements of the gospel and the Catholic faith in it. And so even the beginning of the film, it begins by just showing the coast, and it's like panning over the coast and showing the beauty of Ireland. I think he's trying, I don't know if he's just setting the stage of where it is, but to me it was, you see this dark, brooding beauty juxtaposed against what you're going to see the next scene, which is just hearing about ugliness. It's shocking you. It's from beautiful and mysterious to anything but. And I think he's doing that constantly. But with this character in the communion, whether he intended it or not, the fact is it's showing this is the source of communion and there's a hypocrisy going on. And what's interesting is that the only time that the character of Father James gets angry and really lets out, well, he does in the bar, but the only time he really attacks somebody is his brother priest, and he accuses him of hypocrisy. And I love what he does with him, because he's like, I forget exactly what he said, but it's like, why'd you become a priest? Why didn't you just become like an accountant in an insurance firm? And he uses some very strong language in that. But in that moment, he's calling out the fact that this priest is being a hypocrite, almost taking it all out onto all this hypocrisy going on in the village, but onto the one man who's supposed to know it. You know?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up those landscape shots, because that's another thing that jumped out to me on this repeated viewing, is that this is a really beautifully shot film, even though much of the screenplay is really just these two-person scenes. You could almost see this as living on the stage because,
oh, for sure.
Because it's really just Brendan Gleeson with another person in these one-on-one encounters.
Absolutely.
And very intimate. But then it's interspersed with these big shots of the coast, you know, and the sea and the plains, and it kind of situates this drama. It raises the stakes visually and sort of dramatically, mm-hmm. giving it this like mythic feeling. There's a moment in the film when he's out on a picnic with his daughter, and he brings up, we're given to think, you know, for like the 100th time, this myth of this like folk tale about the landscape and about the waves in this area and how they came to be. And she repeats it you know, very rotely. And he says, oh, there's not a whole lot of romance in that. And I just think about that landscape where this story is taking place is so romantic. And I so appreciate the choice in this film to to really hit that really hard, because it has this incredibly symbiotic relationship, you know, with the story, the setting, and what's unfolding within it.
I'm really interested in the characterization of this priest. You know, he's clearly good, even heroic in certain respects, but he has some flaws that are really kind of interesting. They go along in some ways with why he's appealing to watch, you know, his dry wit, you know, his sense of humor,
yeah.
His ability to kind of blow off a nasty remark from someone. Even from the first scene in the confessional, the guy, you know, I'm not even going to repeat it, but the guy opens with this line, this graphic line about being molested. And Father's just responding. He says, "You got nothing to say, Father?" And he said, "Certainly a startling opening line." And then the guy says, "You know, what's that irony?" And then he like apologizes. But you can see from the beginning that this he has this habit of like a little bit of deflection,
yeah,
emotional deflection with like irony, sarcasm, things like that. And that's something that gets him in trouble a little bit with people in different points of the film. But of course, you see it. Some of the other characters, it's much, much worse.
Yeah,
they're much more black-hearted.
Yeah,
certainly. In particular, the doctor, you know, the atheist doctor, played by Aidan Gillen, who's in a number of other great in a number of TV shows and things. He has this tendency to deflect a little bit, and he is a sincere man, but occasionally his instinctive response is a little bit.
Yeah, well, I think it just serves to make this character very relatable and very human, you know. Yeah. And so, you know, he's a saint, but he's not a saint. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, he's a holy man, but he's also an imperfect, he's a flawed man.
Well, that's why I think it's a really great image of the priesthood in its reality. And what I was saying in the beginning of our conversation, it doesn't give into sentimentality, where the priest is either sappy or he's, you know, or he's just saintly with no flaws. There's a great quote of Saint Jose Maria Escrivá. He said, "If I was going to write a book on the lives of the saints, I would want to call it The Faults of the Saints," because so often we read the lives of the saints and they're just like, it's so saccharine. There's you never hear about any of their struggles or any of their difficulties. And this is a movie about a man who's a priest, and he's a man. He goes through the struggles of patience and his own limitations. He's obviously a man who has suffered as well. I mean, he's a widower. And so he's been through that darkness. And, you know, when his daughter attempts suicide, and in the beginning of the film, he picks her up, and he's hurting, but at the same time, there is a kind of disconnect there of some sort. Now, maybe it's some of the Irish coldness, but it's clear that he's struggling with his own emotional situation. And as a priest, being able to watch that, it's like, wow, it is a beautiful thing when people are able to realize your humanity and to give you the space to be able to be fully human, which means striving for sainthood, but at the same time, you're going to fall short at times, right? And that's one of the great difficulties, I would say, one of the great challenges of the priesthood is we are another Christ, but the one thing I'm always very aware of is that I'm not. I mean, like, I am sacramentally, but I fall short every hour on actually being Christ.
And you also have to think, like, how does one survive in that situation of, you know, just constantly being bombarded with such contempt? It's like, if you're going to keep your sanity, it's almost like you have to develop like a witty way of kind of deflecting a lot of this stuff. Mm-hmm.
But it also goes along with his reserve in like the way he responds to the way people reveal, people make direct attacks on him, but they also are like very open with their vice in front of him in a mm-hmm. way that almost is a mockery in itself.
Yeah, right.
And the way that he deals with that is very reserved, because he knows he's not going to get anywhere by just like lecturing them.
So right.
He has to be, he's very reserved in responding to things. There's a couple of areas where, I think the tone, like it rings false to me. So I'm particularly thinking of the scene where the young, dapper young fellow comes to him in the church and is talking about, you know, his distress at not being able to, you know, sleep with a woman, basically, and talking about how he's considering joining the army instead. And, you know, father's response to, you know, things of sexual morality is, people talking about those things is very restrained. But when it comes to this army thing, he almost starts ranting.
Hmm.
You know, he kind of rants about, you know, this the psychoticness of joining the army in peacetime. Can people join the army because they want to find an excuse to kill? But, you know, you don't see an exception to that in the Fifth Commandment. And
yeah,
it almost feels like the filmmaker's point of view coming in a little bit, like this is their idea of what a good modern day priest would get more upset about than these other things.
Yeah.
Not that the other sure. things are being, you know, excused. They're clearly treated as something that the Catholic Church considers to be wrong. But
right.
But you can kind of see that imbalance there in
yeah.
that scene. And then I'm not sure what to make of he at the end of the scene, he tells the guy, well, have you considered, you know, going to, you know, a bigger town where you might find more women with loose morals? And I'm not really sure what to make of that suggestion.
Yeah. When I was in the seminary, I remember showing this film one year. And that was the scene that a lot of the seminarians bristled at.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I like the way he responds to this character, Milo. I totally hear what you're saying about the killing thing and talking about the commandments. But when he makes the recommendation, like, okay, well, before you go off and join the army and try to vent some of your frustration by killing somebody, why don't you try going to Dublin or London or New York and meet someone? I almost feel that, like, at the very least, he's drawing him out into reality, into interactions with real people. He's already asked him, like, do you watch pornography? And he's said, you know, I've watched basically every kind. And when someone is stuck in that, it's almost like it might actually be a better thing for you to, like, to actually be interacting with real people in the real world and not in this fantasy. So I don't know, you know, it's like you can question like the prudence of the remark of or of the specific, you know, suggestion. But it doesn't seem to me like necessarily, well, like, you know, it seems to me like it might be him exercising prudence and trying to find something that this person's going to be able to respond to. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Sometimes in counseling people, you have to be willing to concede certain things. Like, he was clear he was not going to get through to him on that issue. I mean, the character kind of goes along with that in that vein throughout the whole film. What he's trying to do, it seems to me, is throw him off his game a little bit, just get him to think about things. So he's throwing stuff up. It's obviously an ongoing relationship, and he comes in. And the character, part of it is just the comedic aspect of it. They're wanting to see this banter back and forth. But there is a moment in counseling where you have to say, okay, this is a no-win scenario. Let me move over to here. And then by saying that sarcastic remark, or maybe you go to Dublin and find, you know, women with loose morals, it's suddenly, he might go, oh, wow, like, you get it. Like, oh, okay, I'm going to think about that. But then that's going to lead to a further conversation of, that's not actually what you're looking for, you know. But I think he needs to lead him along a little bit in that way.
That character, actually, I believe, is a reference to Diary of a Country Priest, because there's a scene in that book and film where he gets a ride on a motorcycle from a soldier.
Hmm.
And it's like the one moment of like real human joy that the character experiences in the whole story. In this point, he's not getting a ride on a motorcycle, but he's watching the guy ride off on a motorcycle who wants to go be a soldier. So
right,
I can't help but think that that's a somewhat of a reference there.
Right.
The other scene that bothered me, and I will say my first viewing, I loved the movie. My second viewing a couple years later, I kind of like was hung up on a couple of these scenes that bothered me. And then my third viewing this past week, I was just able to accept the intent behind those scenes without getting hung up on like the specifics, you know. The scene where at the first scene with his fellow priest, who he's discussing, his fellow priest is kind of lamenting the things, sorts of things you hear in confessions today. And at a certain point, you know, Father James warns him off breaking the sacramental seal. But I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong, Father. But I think that by that point, he's already clearly broken the seal.
Oh, he was certainly breaking the seal.
But I think that this is not the filmmaker's, you know, intent. I think maybe they're just not clear on exactly how strict the seal is. I mean, Father James,
or it's just showing his hypocrisy deeper,
right? But Father James acts like you're pushing it, or you've just slipped a little bit. But even before, well before that, I think he could be said to have broken the seal. I mean, I would even be people would be surprised how strict it is. I don't know if this is absolutely a rule or more of a mechanism of caution. But I had a priest a couple of years ago who I confessed to, and I was talking to afterwards, tell me, you know what? Don't, if you want to talk about something you mentioned in confession, you can't act as though I already know what you said. You have to bring it up again and like say that stuff. And I didn't know that it went.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. You know, you need to say, or if someone says, we'll talk about this later, you say, do I have your permission to talk to you about this later? You know, and then you want them still to bring it up, you know?
Right. So I didn't even know it went that strict. So my sense is that it's a combination of, yes, showing his hypocrisy, but also just the way, the exact way that like level that they take it to. I suspect the filmmaker maybe isn't aware of exactly how strict it is.
Yeah, I don't think so. And quite frankly, when you hear interviews with McDonagh, I don't think he wasn't looking for exact accuracy. And quite frankly, the catechesis that goes on in places like Ireland and stuff really is, it slips so much. I mean, even good Catholics don't know very much. I mean, we see that in the United States as well, where it's people say, oh, I went to Catholic school my whole life. I really get it. And then when you're really talking about the faith, I know on my podcast, when I'm doing RCIA classes, I constantly have people I know tell me, I just didn't know that about the church or about this aspect or teaching or something. And it's just because most of the time what we learn stops in probably about 14 or 15 years old. If we're lucky, we went that far, maybe went to a Catholic high school. But so I don't fault him for that. I would hope that, and it seems to me by how he vested and walked and talked, that he had a priest that was a consultant or something on the film, at least in some way.
Yeah, the trappings are very well executed in this film, because that's another thing you see a lot of times in movies. It's like the idea of Catholicism or of the priesthood, and you know, like they're just messing up certain liturgical things or vestments or little details that would be obvious to a Catholic but not so obvious to a Hollywood producer. This film does a very good job of crossing the T's and dotting the I's in terms of its portrayal.
Yeah.
And there's a good chance that most of them are Irish. They're Catholics. Yeah.
McDonagh's not a practicing Catholic. We should probably mention that. But he, you know, he...
It's obviously raised Catholic. Yeah.
So,
Which is something that I'll also say about his brother, Martin McDonagh, both of them. They write with the sort of characteristic, you know, depth and moral sense of a Catholic, or of, at least of someone who's raised Catholic and knows the truth about the world. And they benefit from that, even if in their personal lives, they're not necessarily, you know, still practicing or faithful. It's something that sure. I think comes up with a lot of artists, who are reared in the truth. They continue to have access to things in a way that you don't get from other artists outside of the fold.
Right.
Absolutely.
McDonagh said in interviews, I believe, you know, basically he wanted to set himself a challenge with this film to write a really good character, a heroic character.
Hmm.
And, you know, specifically a priest, but also just the challenge of writing a really interesting, good character in general. I mean, people think, and you can see it just from the stories that are told nowadays, especially, I think even more, perhaps even more in television than in films, that there's like so many anti-heroes and like seriously flawed or perverted characters. And the fact that they're conflicted is supposed to kind of absolve them in advance,
right. or you know, make them more interesting. Yeah. You know, it's like we have this idea that a complicated or conflicted character is a more interesting character. And I just don't think that's true. And I think that's borne out by the kinds of heroes that we're getting in a lot of media today.
Right. I also think with this particular character, you know, the ones who are doing all the interesting things in quote unquote interesting things in the town are, they're really dull. Like, I mean, sin is, and that's something, you know, you can, as a priest, I say this, just 10 commandments, there's just so many ways you can break them. It really is not. Sin is not interesting, even as a priest. Like when I first became a priest, people were like, oh my gosh, you're going to hear confessions. And I'm like, yeah. I mean, after the first couple of days, you're like, yeah, it really is not that interesting. Sin's not interesting. Mercy is, forgiveness is, which is the whole point of the film. And forgiveness is underrated. And mercy is underrated. So what makes him a complex character is that he is flawed and human. At the same time, his trajectory is towards the good, and that the flawed hero is fine if their trajectory is towards the good. But when you make it ambiguous, the film really, when you think once he dies, you think this is the most nihilistic film I've ever seen in my life. And then the next scene, the final scene of the film redeems the whole thing.
Yeah. I remember watching it the first time and actually kind of wishing that there wasn't that epilogue, that we were just left with this death at the end.
Yeah, that's so you.
Well, yeah, totally. But, you know, I think that for any Catholic watching this, they're going to be able to see the logic of the crucifixion in here, the logic of the passion, and sure, know that there is redemption in this. I think that the reason the epilogue is so actually beneficial to the film is for everybody else. It makes it clear, you know, that this act is not, you know, it's not a victory of evil, that like it's life that vanquishes death.
Yeah.
It's forgiveness that and mercy that vanquishes sin and transgression. Right. And
absolutely.
But what's interesting about the epilogue is a lot of what it shows is the characters just going about their usual ways, right?
Yeah.
You know, and right, then you do get this forgiveness with the daughter forgiving,
yeah,
it seems, that the killer. But a lot of it, you know, you see the priest who's seems to have left the priesthood after Father James yelled at him. He's reading Opening the God Delusion by Richard Dawkins in a library, which is really funny.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, everybody else kind of going about their usual nonsense.
Yeah, you see his spirit living on in her. And in fact, you see the spirit of Christ, in whose image he is as a priest, living on in her and being able to go and bring this mercy, which is exactly the very thing that this man needs the most. He needs, what was robbed from him was his innocence and his, and really, you know, his hope. What does she do? She goes and does the very thing that brings and restores innocence and hope, and that's forgiveness. And perhaps his redemption needs to go through the lens of this evil that he committed. You know, it has to be washed through that, and he comes out okay on the other side. So there's a lot of hope there, and you really see the effects of the Paschal mystery. You know, it's aptly named Calvary, because you know also see
it really is
what he's made for.
One other thing I wanted to say about the film that I got from this most recent viewing was how successfully it illustrates time and the passage of time. So the film is sort of framed with these, they're not quite intertitles, but they're almost intertitles that introduce each day of the week. So we get this threat at the beginning of the movie that, you know, I'll kill you in a week's time. And then it's Monday, and then it's Tuesday, and then Wednesday. Mm-hmm. And I think that one of the effects that this has on us as viewers is that we become really aware throughout the film of how this priest is choosing to spend his final days, basically. Almost every minute becomes precious. Yeah. And to see him not doing the kinds of things that would be characteristic of someone who has to get their house in order, right? Tending to financial matters or calling, you know, family members or you know, behaving really selfishly. He's doing things like getting up early in the morning and going fishing. And he's not even particularly good at fishing, but he hears it's therapeutic. You know, he's making his usual rounds, and he's spending long walks with his daughter.
Yeah. I think those are the moments where you feel the weight of what may happen to him the most, is the time he's spending with his daughter. Yeah.
Right. But even then, he's speaking to her about her and about their his being a father to her, and her, you know, despair or hope. It's not so much about him trying to take, you know, oh, I need to have this time with my daughter before this reckoning comes.
There's no self-pity or yes. look at me, I'm suffering too. And that's the beauty of the priest. Like,
right.
You know, you're human and you go through that. But as a priest, like, you also know that, like, no one ultimately, like, I mean, the people you're serving, they want you to be there for them. You're not going to, you can't look to them for sympathy or anything like that. You know, once in a while, someone's kind and they get it, you know, but, and it's beautiful to see that, because he's doing exactly what Jesus did during Holy Week, is he's going to all the people that he needs to go to, all the different groups. He's reaching out to them. He's reaching out to the civil authority. He's reaching out to the religious authority. He's reaching out to the poor and, you know, all those things. He's lining it up. He knows it's coming. It reminded me of, I don't know if it was St. Francis de Sales or someone can, maybe you know, there's a famous quote. It said, if you knew you were going to die tomorrow, what would you do differently? And they said, absolutely nothing.
Wow.
Like, I'd keep doing exactly what it is that I'm doing, because that's what God's calling me to do.
Yeah, that's worth thinking about, you know, I think nowadays in this sort of era marked by hysteria and fear of death, you know, what's there to do but what you would be doing anyways, you know?
Precisely. And, you know, that's a good point that you make today, with everything going on, is that we really have to live that holiness just in the everyday. And I, to me, think that this film is one of the great evangelical films. Like, if you're looking for a film to sit down and watch with friends, you know, The Lord of the Rings is great and all this, like Calvary, you look at people and go, oh, why? It's, there's so much darkness in it. I think it's better than the sacraments. I mean, it gets to the heart of things. And I remember showing this in the university. So I was at a public university and I showed it in class. And here I am, I'm in a collar, I'm teaching the class. And, you know, people expect, oh, the priest. You know, I showed some great films of all different religions, but this is the one I wanted for Catholicism, because, and the people responded to it more than any other film we did, because it spoke to their heart. Like, whether it was the particular sins or was the particular darknesses, or it was the fact that a film brought up issues with the church that they had heard before and weren't afraid of, wasn't like watching the priest's reaction that he wasn't scandalized by it, or, oh, what do I say? That it was, and then they asked me those questions afterwards, and it was the same kind of thing, a great conversation about it. I think what it shows is we're not afraid to run from reality. As a matter of fact, we're going to plunge into the depth, into the very heart of the realest of real, which is this man's suffering or anyone's suffering, and that Christ has an answer to it, and that the church is the bride of Christ, and she's delivering that answer. I just think it's a brilliant film for that.
This priest is, I wanted to bring up another scene, that this priest is so honest. In the final scene, like right before he dies, the guy asks, you know, the priest's dog is killed, not by the guy who ends up killing him. And it's devastating to him. And yeah. And he says, well, okay, did you cry? And he's like, yeah. He's like, okay. And when you read, and when you heard about what your other priests were doing to people, molesting people, did you cry then? And he says, no. I suppose that, you know, it was just like, felt distant for me as something you read in the paper. And I was like, wow, that's such like an awkward thing to have to say at that moment, but he's so honest about it. It's really interesting because it's so unpoetic and yeah. An unheroic a moment.
It is. I don't know how honest that is. Whether, I mean, I think every priest, well, you cried. I don't know. Maybe I think there was anger was probably the first,
yeah,
the first reaction, you know, but that is, it's a good question, is that are you in communion with these guys as well as with me and with everybody else? And he kind of issues them a challenge. And I do love at the end is, say your prayers, Father. And he just looks at me and says, I have. You know, and it's just like, I'm ready. And but yeah, he's really brutally honest to a point, which is the exact thing that's going to get through to a hard heart, is truth.
I also like this film is very funny, and I particularly like the portrayal of the other priest. You know, so often when you see, I'm going to go ahead and describe him as a corrupt priest, and not in any way that would get him ever in the newspapers, right? But you know, usually when people think of a corrupt priest, a portrayal of a corrupt priest in, you know, mainstream work of fiction, it would be, you know, this priest preaches harsh, rigid morality to control people's lives and things like that. Well, this is a priest. This is a much more realistic thing for our day and age, at least. The priest is not challenging people because of fear of human respect, because of fear of losing donations. What does he say? There's some suspicion. It turns out to be wrong, but there's some suspicion that you know, a man might be beating a woman in the town, and there's some suspicion that it may be this guy who's an African immigrant, and they're talking about it. And he goes, "Oh, you might want to be careful with that, Father. You know, the church can't be seen to be getting involved with matters of diversity and the like." You know, and it's just such a funny line that, you know, it's interesting, especially coming from the perspective of a lapsed Catholic filmmaker, to put that in there, as this is one of the ways that this priest is contemptible, that he is afraid of this matter, which is irrelevant to the situation at hand, but which you so often see in our world shaping people's responses to problems in the world.
It's that idea of playing it safe. Father James is not, the character is not playing it safe. He's playing it with love. And sometimes that means going into the dark space. That's what this other guy did. The other priest, whose name I don't remember, quite frankly, because he was unmemorable as far as a person goes. Interesting character, but he's not going to where the person suffering is. And because of that, he's just going to a policy, or he's going to an idea. And that's what happens in society so often. You know, people will often try to accuse priests of taking a side or something, but it's not like we're unliked by, you know, it's just like, for instance, we're pro-life. And so a lot of times the Democratic platform is against us. And yet at the same time, we're also against the death penalty. So a lot of Republicans don't like that. And there's this back and forth thing. You say, yeah, we're not here to make friends. We're here to make sons and daughters of God. And that means speaking the truth where it's necessary. And sometimes, you know, being quiet and not taking sides on something that's kind of irrelevant.
On Catholic Culture Audiobooks, we recently did a reading from Father Paul Mankowski, a Jesuit who passed away last year, an essay he wrote called Tames in Clerical Life. And this other priest at the parish at Brendan Gleeson's priest character is at, he's a tame. He's definitely a tame, you know? So if you want to know what a tame is, go head over to Catholic Culture Audiobooks, listen to Tames in Clerical Life, or watch this movie, Calvary. It holds up really well. But we're being assaulted by the sun in here in our studio. So I think that we should wrap up this conversation. Father James, thanks so much for joining us to talk about this movie. And, you know, you have your own podcast. Why don't you pitch that to us? I listened to it. It's a great podcast. You mentioned it earlier in the episode, but where can people go to listen to you talk about more things?
Sure. It's available where all podcasts are available. It's called Holiness for the Working Day. Holiness for the Working Day. And it's just, homilies and classes and particular talks. There's a particular series of talks on there I think people would enjoy right now called Mindfulness in an Anxious World. I did a 9-part series on just how, as Catholics, do we approach both from the psychological and the spiritual, how to deal with anxiety, especially in a time of fear and uncertainty. So it's been quite popular with people. But Holiness for the Working Day. Thanks for giving me the pitch there.
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know, I'll say that I think that one of the great things about your podcast is, for me, there have been times when I've, you know, had to be subject to some pretty weak sauce preaching. You know, thanks be to God, the Mass is the Mass. I'm receiving the sacraments, but it's a real difficulty when you have to go long periods of time just receiving no nourishment from obviously there's always something there for us in the homily, but sometimes you have to dig a little bit more, and sometimes it's like, you know, just finding like the little grains like in the mud or something. That's a terrible metaphor, but my point is that this your podcast is a great supplement for those of us who may at different times find a dearth of good holy preaching. Holiness for the Working Day is a great way to sort of get that in and track the liturgical year as well.
Thank you. Thanks. I want to say thank you so much for this podcast, yours, because one of the more important things we can do, we talk about all the problems in our culture today, and people look for political solutions or they look for punditry. The most important thing I think we can do is just build beautiful culture. Like the culture of death is beating at our door. Then build a culture of life, build beauty. And what you're doing is you're looking at films and culture and trying to find the beauty and the truth in it, even if they're not overtly Catholic, which I think is chock full of goodness.
Amen.
Thanks, Father. Yeah, thanks for this discussion. This was really fun.
Great. Yeah. Look forward to talking to you guys soon.
So our next film, sun is so bright. It's right in my eye. Our next is... I can still feel it.
Do not go gentle into that good night.
Okay. Our next film for Lent is...